والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. اللهم صل على سيد محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to deepen and enrich our intimacy with Him through learning, so that we can fulfill the purposes of our soul, because the soul wants to learn. That's what it's all about. That's the purpose of a soul. In the marrow of intimacy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, understanding the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is our purpose here? What we're trying to achieve is quality of Muslim life. That's what we want. So by understanding the deen and what makes it tick and what it pivots upon, what its priorities are, and how it sees the universe, right? Because you want to navigate through the wilderness, right? You want to get through the forest safely to the other side. But you have to have a 20,000 foot perspective on what's the nature of this forest, which pathways are safe, which are unsafe, huh? Where the poison ivy is, right? And so on and so forth. So two things have to happen. We have to know how to travel through the world in a tactical sense, but we also have to understand the greater perspective. And with Riyadh al-Salihin, we're getting both at the same time. And we're raising our thaqafa of the deen. And when you raise your thaqafa, or your culture, your knowledge culture of the deen, it's very satisfying. It's very fulfilling. And that feeling of being satisfied and fulfilled is actually your soul feeling a little bit healthier, right? Because you're fulfilling the purpose of your existence. So we are still in the chapter of Bab al-Mubadarati ila al-Khayrat, chapter 10. The chapter of rushing, hastening, as it were, to good things. وَحَثُّ مَنْ تَوَجَّهَ لِخَيْرٍ عَلَى الْإِقْبَالِ عَلَيْهِ بِالْجِدِّ مِنْ غَيْرِ تَرَدُّدٍ. And encouraging the person who's directed themselves toward good things, good purposes, good intentions, good deeds, goodness in general, to direct themselves in that way, or to approach with seriousness and without hesitation. Don't wait, because the opportunity to do something good might just pass you by. You gotta jump on it. So we've arrived at the fifth hadith, and Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam akhadha sayfan yawm Uhudin faqal. The Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam took, here it says, a sword. Elsewhere in the narrations, it will say his sword. He offered up his very own sword. In this narration, he took up a sword on the Day of Judgment. The Day of Uhud. He took up a sword and offered it forward on the Day of Uhud. And he said, "May ya'khudhu hadha." No. Restart.
It's okay. No, it's fine.
Yeah. Or pick up a quarter of the way through. Munir came to save the day. May yakhudhu minni hadha. Who will take this sword from me? Fabasatu aydiyahum. So they all reached out for it. Huh? All of them. And kullu insanin minhum yakulu ana. I'll take it, I'll take it. And then he rephrased himself. He said, فَمَنْ يَأْخُذُهُ بِحَقِّهِ. But who's going to take it with its proper due? فَأَحْجَمُ الْقَوْمُ. They all backed off and withdrew their hands. After everybody's reaching for it and said, I'll take it, I'll take it. They all, Sahabat Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they understood that this is something that they're not sure if they're ready for. With its proper due, that's a different story. Who's going to jump forward and do his best? Well, I'll jump forward and I'll give everything I've got, leave it all out on the field, as it were. Huh? But then, with its proper due, from the mouth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but one person, they all withdrew their hands, but Abu Dujana, and Abu Dujana, what was his name? Sirwan, Can Abu Dujana. Simak ibn Kharsha was Abu Dujana. His name was Simak ibn Kharsha. Abu Dujana steps forward and he said, Ana akhudhu bihaqqihi. I will take it with its right. Interesting. We see here the use of ana. We all want to avoid saying I. A'udhu billahi min ana. We've been taught this, so we have that knee-jerk reaction. A'udhu billahi min kalimat ana. But we'll see the Sahaba. Abu Dujana is a special case, right? But we'll see the Sahaba saying ana. We'll see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying I, me. The problem is not saying the word I. The problem is not saying the word me. The problem ultimately is in being self-centered. Sometimes you have to say I. Sometimes you have to say me. Are you doing it in the context of being a self-centered person? Or are you doing it because here you need to say who you are, what you're going to do, or what's happened, what's going on, and you use that word. So we have to go beyond cut and paste approaches to the practice of Islam. We have to think about the bigger perspective of things, because there's all types of ways of being very, very self-centered without ever saying ana. Right? So what's the bigger objective, the bigger purpose? Al-Muslim kayyisun fatin. The Muslim is smart and perceptive, right? Or perspicacious. You know perspicacious? Is that one of your spelling words yet? Tayyib. It will be. Tayyib. So he said, I will take it with its right. Abu Dujana was a seriously brave gentleman. فَأَخَذَهُ. And so he took it. In this narration, فَفَلَقَ بِهِ هَامَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. And he cleaved awake straight through the heads of the idolaters. Meaning everywhere Abu Dujana went, he cut awake through the idolaters. Meaning he mowed them all down with that sword. SubhanAllah. The point was that Abu Dujana had an intention to do well. And he didn't hesitate. And he went and he executed something that he knew he was able to do. Okay? With tawfiq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam giving you the sword at your back, who's going to stop you? SubhanAllah. Elsewhere, we all know the narrations of Abu Dujana. He took that sword and he was probably a bit, right, puffed up, right? He's the one who took the sword, was given it, right? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam makes a little dua for him. And the two armies are lined up on the battlefield, and Abu Dujana is strutting bi kul ma'na al-kalima, in every sense of the word, strutting back and forth in front of his own compatriots, in front of the lines of the Sahaba, in front of the mushrikeen, right? And the word strutting that was used here is yatabakhtar, right? Min al-zuhum. Right? Very proudly and boastfully he's strutting. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam points toward Abu Dujana as he's strutting back and forth. He said, that is a type of walking that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes. Except for in a moment like this. SubhanAllah. Except for in a moment like this. Context. Situational awareness. That was the time for it. Because being full of all that confidence is not going to make the mushrikun, the idolaters, those who want to bring harm to others, those who want to run people out of their own towns and so on, it's not going to make them feel any more comfortable. It's not going to make them feel any more bold if they think that these other people are not afraid of them. So context is important. Not the context of battle per se, but the ability or capacity or influence of context to affect the expectations of a situation. There may be a completely different situation, a completely different set of actions that we might let slide in a given context. Right? So context awareness. You can't be aware of context unless you know the actual landscape or the relief of the cartography of the place where you want to work. In Chicago, there was a group of very, very well-meaning suburban young professionals who decided that they were going to roll out this big project on the south side of Chicago and help people out and do all of these things, but they didn't know anything about the south side of Chicago, but they rolled in, they felt they had a lot of money behind them and all of this, and someone said, "What y'all doing here?" He said, "We're here to help you and do all these things," and say, "Well, do you know anything about us? Do you know anything about what's needed over here? Maybe you should go back to where you're from and figure out how to help the people where Allah put you." You know? So, when it comes to knowing and understanding, sometimes if we're not from a particular context, we just need to be quiet and listen and learn and become students. Right? Allah help us. So, the commentators will also say that what this hadith demonstrates is the courage of Abu Dujana and his particular readiness to go forward and do the goodness that was in his intention. It wasn't meant to imply any cowardice on the part of the other Sahaba. We also have to listen to the Deen of Islam if we want to understand it correctly. We have to be careful about looking backwards at Islam historically and having ideas and judging the people there, or like sort of like maybe chuckling and thinking ourselves superior because we really know what the archers on the little mountain, the Tel at the Battle of Uhud, should have done, because we all know in hindsight what they should have done. That's not for us. It's for us to learn from the lessons that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has stitched into the time of the past, for us to understand and be respectful for anyone who saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a state of faith, because that's what makes a person a sahabi after the bi'tha. So they have to see the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a believer after the revelation began at Mecca, and that's what secures, mashallah, Sahaba. Allahumma put us in their neighborhood in Jannah. Right? That's some good real estate. No, but the price is high. It's expensive. You thought the Bay Area was expensive. Subhanallah. Allah help us. Hadith number 6. An Zubayr ibn Adi. He said, Atayna Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu. فَشَكَوْنَا إِلَيْهِ مَا نَلْقَى مِنَ الْحَجَّاجِ. So, Az-Zubayr ibn Adi says that we went to Anas ibn Malik, and this is after the passing, long after the passing of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, deep into the Umayyad dynasty. It's after the Khulafa al-Rashidun. This is after the death of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Anas ibn Malik, who had been the servant boy in the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is most definitely an old man at this point and has seen a lot and learned a lot. Because what happens if you grow up and your elementary school is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and your junior high school is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and high school is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, and college is Omar and Uthman and Ali, subhanAllah. So they said, we went to Anas ibn Malik and we complained of everything that Hajjaj was doing to us. all the stuff that we were being faced with because of Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. Who was Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf? Right? One of the generals under Muawiyah. Okay? And he was known as As-Saffah, the blood spiller. Hajjaj was not a Sahabi. Hajjaj did not care. Hajjaj was ready to kill anyone who got in the way of whoever it was he happened to be serving. We have a lot of Hajjajs around. It's haram to point any type of edged weapon or any type of weapon itself toward another Muslim, even in play. This is haram. And this is one of the first things that we learn if we start our deen off by studying Riyadus Salihin. Riyadus Salihin is extremely important. You don't play pointing a real dangerous weapon. Nerf guns and little play toys and stuff like that, that's different. But anything that could actually hurt a person is haram to ever do that, let alone hurt another Muslim. And where are we at in this world? Well, some people believe that we're very pragmatic. I say that we have a lot of cowardice in this ummah. Because the roots of every single instance of abuse, whether it is in someone's house, whether it is on someone's block, or whether it is in someone's society or country, is two things, one of two things. It is either a dead soul. This person is now lower than an animal, not even human anymore, or it's fear, cowardice. And the bully who is actually a coward is only emboldened further when good people who understand the situation, decline to do anything about it. Husna dhan and don't want to rock the boat and all of these things that go on so that my day goes smooth. Or maybe I have some benefit I might gain from the current status quo. Don't want to rock the boat. Why? Because I don't want to be a nuisance, or because the status quo works out for me. Who is it that's going to step up? Right? Bullies need only one thing, a spanking. Right? They need to be shut down. But how many angelic, wonderful, brilliant, knowledgeable bullies do we have running about telling us what we should and shouldn't do and trying to control everything? Someone needs to step up to them. We have all types of problems. Why do you think no young people want to go to your masajid? Because there are people who are fighting tooth and nail, contradicting all of the ethics and teachings of the very deen that we can't claim that the particular masajid is there to bring to who? To the people who are members of the club? Or to the people who Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam meant when he said, sitting in al-Baqi' al-Gharqat, وَدِدْتُ لَوْ رَأَيْنَا إِخْوَانَنَا. Oh, how we wish that we would have the opportunity to see our brothers. And who is included in that? People who, not only are they not Muslim, they haven't even come into existence yet, and he's thinking of them. إِنِّي رَحْمَةٌ مُهْدَاتٌ. I am nothing but a gift of compassion to the world. No. These people need to be shut down. That's why your young people don't want to come to the masjid. Huh? Because there's a crusty and ugly and boring and offensive status quo. And no matter how much you vacuum the carpets or replace them every year, it still stinks. But it's a stink that can only be smelled at the level of arwah, with people's souls. They know something is not right here. Subhanallah. Where is the courage? Allah. Na'am. So we complain to Anas about what we were facing from Hajjaj. So of course, Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, his army is the one that surrounds Mecca, is sending manjaniq, catapults against the Kaaba, that's actually hitting the Kaaba and breaking its bricks, surrounding, not letting the people eat, killing the Sahaba, subhanAllah, left and right. He kills Abdullah ibn Zubayr, the son of Asma, into Abi Bakr. So Anas says to them, Yasbiru, be patient. He's not surprised. He's already seen the battle of Safin. No. He said, be patient. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَأْتِي زَمَانٌ إِلَّا وَالَّذِي بَعْدُهُ شَرٌ مِنْهُ. Be patient, because no time comes except for the time that comes after it will be more evil, will be worse. حَتَّى تَلْقَوْ رَبَّكُمْ, until you meet your Lord. It's only going to get worse from here on out. And in reality, it only got worse from there on out. And we're surprised. But this is exactly what was promised to us by Allah's Messenger, alayhi salatu wa salam. This was exactly what was expected by the Sahaba who were raised up under the Messenger. And that there would be qabidi al jamarat, that there would be people who hold on to the deen like holding on to a hot coal. That's not easy. And that's how he described the believers at the ends of time. That for them to hold on to their deen will be like someone trying to hold tight onto a hot coal. Is it hot yet? Ask yourself. Those are words on paper. How many times have we heard them? But ask yourself, is it hot yet? Sometimes we forget. It's hot. It's hot. Right? Are you going to be the one who keeps holding on though? How aziz is it to you? We'll never know unless we know the deen. Because people who don't know the deen are like the person in Aqidah, where our theologian imams have said that it is a sin for an educated Muslim to not know the evidences, the adilla, for their own points of Aqidah, if they have the capacity to know. Why? Because faith is accepted from a person who cannot explain to you why they believe. But they believe that Allah is one, and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is the final messenger. They believe that, but they can't shore it up with evidence, with supporting evidence, with supporting knowledge. If that person is educated with the slightest degree of capacity to have learned that in their lives, they are in sin. Why? Because even though they believe the right thing, they don't know why and cannot explain why, and therefore they are susceptible to having their own faith be undermined. By the slightest wind that blows, by the slightest pitiful and petty science teacher that has all types of crazy ideas about atheism, and because we don't understand what he's talking about, we think he might have a point. But in reality, everybody in the philosophy of science is laughing at him and looks at him like a hack who's just pulling in the money from the publicity, because he himself doesn't really understand the overarching philosophy even of the physical sciences themselves. But we don't know that because we're a little bit light in the aql area. SubhanAllah. And we're worried about dieting for our bodies, but our brains have been dieting for way too long. Very slim, very fashionable, right? MashaAllah. Doesn't weigh much at all. You can fit right into that nice, cute dress or whatever it has. Mahek. Or, you know, like the tightest little, you know, toboggan or hat or whatever it is. Kulansuwa in Arabic. Tell you. But the same thing here, if we do not deepen our thaqafa of the deen itself, our knowledge culture of Islam itself, we are susceptible to believing things we hear about our own deen on the evening news. We're susceptible of thinking that the demeanor and behavior of Muslims themselves somehow represents the deen of the creator of the universe and the final messenger who was chosen before the universe was ever created, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of conflating those two. And then our faith goes out the window with the slightest breeze. Allah help us. Allahumma alimna ma yanfa'una wa anfa'na bima 'allamtana. And he went on to say, سَمِعْتُهُ مِن نَبِيِّكُمْ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. And I heard that statement from your Prophet, صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. SubhanAllah. So we know this to be the case. That's why when you encounter someone who deeply and profoundly and truly loves Allah and His Messenger, it doesn't matter what he or she may be up to and all about. The fact that they have that gem of hubbillahi wa rasulihi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in their heart, that is incredibly significant. The fact that you may find a person who is involved in, as Imam Shafi'i said, every single sin in the dunya after shirk and ilm al-kalam, right, as it was heard, as understood at the time of Imam Shafi'i, of course, philosophy, we'll say, Greek philosophy, is better than to be confront Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yani, with something other. Meaning that they could be involved in anything, but they have that gemstone, that kernel of love in their heart, mashallah. That they respect the maqam of taqwa and salah. And when they encounter someone who truly has taqwa and truly has salah and truly has the gentle yet resolute demeanor of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because not every strict person is actually muttaqi and salih. Not every strict person is like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because there is a difference between iltizam and the rigidity and mechanicalness, the robotics of what some people call strictness. And sometimes it's just because they don't have a more elegant vocabulary. And what they mean is multazim, someone who adheres, right, to the teachings of the deen very well. Some people, that's just their demeanor, to act like robots, right? And in a bind, do they know how to be, show rahmah? Do they know how to show hil? Right? And that's a test. Test them and see if they can be halim. Go and annoy them a lot and see what their response is. They start screaming and shouting at you because they're real annoyed and all of this. Well, sometimes, I mean, some of my shiukh are kind of halim, but, you know, maybe they would lose their temper every once in a while, but even the most, you know, fiercest of them had a heart of gold, and they cared about people's situations. They could put themselves in another person's shoes and maybe think about what it's like to see the world from their side and show that hilm, that forbearance or compassion. Yeah, and how we got on that, I do not know. Al-Hadith al-Sabi'ah. So we know that it's only going to get harder. So when you have someone who shows up with the love of Allah and His Messenger, realize that that is everything right there. And that is a good start. Because there are people who can be as rigid as you like. Front line of prayer, got the siwak going, right? 24/7, mashallah. Don't even need a dental plan. Huh? See what? Going 24/7. But they'll fight you to the death and say things like, be careful not to love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam too much. There's no such thing as loving Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam too much, because what do you mean? Do you mean that a person goes over the limits of the deen of Islam and now is violating the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and calling it love? Because that's not called love. Right? There is no way to love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam too much. Right? That person does not understand language. And they said it the first time in Arabic language. So clearly, they don't understand English or Arabic. Naam? And that's fine. نَحْنُ أُمَّةٌ أُمِّيٌ لَا نَقْرَأْ وَلَا نَحْسِبْ. We are an unlettered or illiterate ummah. We do not read. The majority of the population, right? Right? There's illiteracy rates, right? And we do not calculate. Meaning that we can embrace and be inclusive of people who are illiterate, right? Or don't understand basic math. So it's okay for people to not understand literature. It's okay for people to not have a grasp of the English language. It's okay if there's Arabs who can't speak Arabic even though they've don't know any other language. They don't have a second language, but they still don't understand Arabic correctly, like we have people who know nothing but English, but they're not very articulate or capable in English. All of that's okay, so long as they're not decision makers in our community, right? And people of Aql know that, subhanAllah. But of course, no time comes, but the time that comes after it is going to be even worse and even harder, right? Until we get to the time that is not being secretly, subtly influenced by the operators on behalf of the Dajjal, that the Dajjal sends out, either knowingly or unknowingly, to prepare for his coming, to habituate us to be comfortable with nastiness, to be comfortable with what is beshet, to be comfortable with what is actually supposed to scare us. To habituate us to heroes who are vampires and heroes who are little shayateen and devils, right? It started with Casper the Friendly Ghost, and where did it get to after that, right? Hellboy or whatever it's called, right? To habituate us toward the normalization of what is actually fundamentally ugly, of ugliness in human nature. To the point where the world is directly dominated by the Dajjal himself, right? It's only going to get worse. Allah help us and prepare us and take us from the earth before any type of fitna that we cannot handle and we might stand to lose our faith in front of. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. The seventh hadith from Abi Huraira radiallahu anhu, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, badiru bil a'mali sab'an. So remember, in order to read the hadith, if the hadith book was written by a proper muhaddith scholar, and it was gathered and they were categorized and put into chapter headings, every hadith in that particular chapter, you look for the, what's called mahal al-shahid. Right? The actual point of citation. Why is this hadith under this chapter? Right? This one is about rushing without hesitation toward doing good. The seventh hadith is very obvious. The Messenger alayhi salat wa salam is telling you, rush to do good actions before seven things happen. The first, I have eyeglasses now. I have to now start remembering to bring them to class. Right? I don't have to do this anymore. هَلْ تَنْتَظِرُونَ إِلَّا فَقْرًا مَنْسِيًّا. What are you waiting to do that good action that you should do? Are you waiting until you are overcome by a poverty that will cause you to forget everything that you're supposed to be doing? No. A poverty that will cause you to forget to do this and forget to do that. Why? Because you're racking your brain trying to figure out how to get you and your family out of this hole, right? How to get health care for you and your family, how to save this member of your family from falling into that hole, right? And so on. How are you supposed to remember even other type of basics or what you can do for another? Or غينًا مطغيًا. Or the other thing that might prevent you from doing a good act is wealth that will cause you to lose your way and forget priorities in the world. Because you become so habituated to certain luxuries, certain comforts, or preoccupation in rushing to maintain a wealth that you forget actual priorities, or you forget the way others might suffer. Or you become so self-impressed, right, that you accept the values of the Protestant work ethic, which means that if I'm wealthy, I am godly. And if so-and-so is poor, right, they are ungodly. Right? And of course, this ideology has nothing to do with work. It has nothing to do with actually having this idea that I have to earn and I have to go out and do what I have to do to take. That's not the Protestant work ethic. Right? Just because the Germans are well organized and efficient and effective and all of these different types of things, and you know, Europe had its industrial revolution and all of that, we don't equate that with another ideology, which is about blaming the poor for their poverty. Right? Enough people in your neighborhood wake up to find one of their relatives hanging from a tree in the front yard, and you think twice before you're too bold in any town that you live in. You think twice because you know that out of the 10 people in the past 5 years that got hung from a tree in your neighborhood, half of them only got hung from a tree because they looked someone in the eye. And what's the first thing you're supposed to do when you go into a job interview? Right? If you haven't lived that, let's not judge people who do. That's only the beginning. I was told when I went to Damascus, to Syria, that this was their country, and I had to learn to do things their way. And I had to respect their culture. I had to respect their story. I had to respect the narrative that got them to where they are and why they do what they do. Right? Because I walked into Damascus knowing full well what the 1980s history was, and every time I saw a soldier walking down the street with his AK-47, like a group of them, two or three, right? I couldn't let them pass by in the very beginning without giving them a hard shoulder and seeing what they were going to do about it. Right? But slowly I learned. Right? I mean, they were like so like surprised they wouldn't do anything, right? But you learn slowly and slowly. And if you respect people and you come to their country, you learn their culture, you respect their story, you respect the circumstances, because it's not your shots to call. I was there for 10 years. In my country, we would have given someone citizenship, but they weren't about to give me citizenship. Right? I used to have to jump over the border to Stura or Irbit, come back, you know, once or twice a year for 10 years. But we did. We respected. And we expect nothing less from people who would come here. Learn our story. Learn why our society is what it is. And we don't want to hear your opinion. We do not want to hear your opinion. If you're a child in the history of this country, even if it's only 250 years old. Allah gave you 2 ears and only one mouth for a reason. Listen and learn and respect. Practice what you preach. Allahumma help me practice what I preach or does not preach. I share. Allah help us. Or you're waiting to do that good deed for what is to come. Maradan, mufsidan, right? A sickness that's going to make you unable to do those good things. Aw haraman mufninan. Like, what if I went to Bosnia? What if I went to Sarajevo or any little village outside of Sarajevo and started talking junk about everybody smoking cigarettes? These people, don't they know that's bad for your health? Don't they know that has a nasty smell? What am I really doing? I'm being absolutely insensitive to a Holocaust that people live through. And they lived through it, and they got through it. And they smoke some cigarettes to calm their nerves in the process, right? Subhanallah. Right? That's not my business. Aw haraman mufnidan, or age, old age, when a person starts to just not be able to gather their thoughts as well as they used to, meaning they're starting to, like, you know, reach that point. Allah matti'na na bi asma'ina wa absarina wa quwwatina wa 'uqulina, right? Idha wasalna ila tilka sin, right? Allah protect our strength and our eyesight and our ears and our minds, right? When we reach old age, if we reach old age. Ya Rabbi. Aw mawtan mujhizan, or a quick death, a sudden death. These are all of the things that, what are you waiting for to do the good deed? Sudden death, when it's too late, right? Oh, number six, ad-dajjala, fasharru ghaibin yuntada, or the Antichrist himself to come, because that is the most evil, absent person who's awaited for, who's waited for. Ya Rabbi. Aw as-sa'ata, or the hour of judgment. فَالسَّاعَةُ أَدْهَى وَأَمَرُ, because the moment of judgment is the worst and most bitter calamity. Allah save us and give us health and help us to get some good things on our record that we can take with us. And some good sadaqa jariya. That's called retirement planning. Where are we at? 8:16. When did we say we were going to stop? 8:30? So you got me for about 14 more minutes. Now, the eighth hadith, also from Abu Hurairah, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said on the day of Khaybar, لَأَعْطِيَنَّ هَذِهِ الرَّايَةَ رَجُلًا يُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ يَفْتَحُ اللَّهُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ, that on the day of the battle of Khaybar, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam announced the evening before. Okay, so all of the details that we know about this incident are not necessarily in this particular narration. And different sahaba memorized an incident or a statement in different ways, with different usages. Perhaps a statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said it with several different variants. But from the moment of the memorization of the sahabi and it's passed on to his or her students, it's sealed historically. Now, a particular narration may be put into a particular chapter because that narration highlights the aspect that the narrative critic or the hadith scholar wants to bring out in this particular chapter. And elsewhere, the same hadith scholar may bring an alternative narration that has a little aspect that narrates what he's trying, the theme that he's gathering in another chapter. So, here, he says, the evening before the battle that we know from other narrations, I am most definitely going to give this banner to a man who loves Allah and His Messenger. Allah will give victory at his hands. And in the other narrations, لَأُعْطِيَنَّ رَايَةَ غَدًا, I will give this banner tomorrow to a man who loves Allah and his messenger, and Allah and his messenger love him. And the law will bring us victory at his hand. So now you know why Omar was extremely excited that night and couldn't sleep. So, Abu Huraira says that Omar ibn al-Khattab said, I never wanted leadership in my life except for that day. On that day, I wanted to be in charge. Why? It's the 21st century. It's 2017. Muslims clearly don't know why, because everybody thinks they should be in charge. Well, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever desires to be in charge should be denied it, should be prevented from it. Because it's a passion, it's a caprice coming from their own ego, and they don't understand how smart they should be that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, who will take this station bihaqqihi, with its due, to pull back their hands like the Sahaba did on the day of Uhud from that sword. But Abu Dujana was the one who was for it. Because we know, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam concurred that he was the one for it. It had his taqriya, which is one of the ways of establishing a sunnah. The one who wants it to be in the position of leadership or to be in charge, they say that the last illness of the heart to be taken out of the heart of a wali, of the wali, is hubriyasa, the love to be at the center, the love to be out front, the love to be in charge. So whoever wants it should be denied it. Why? Because they don't realize the gravity of accountability that they are taking onto their own shoulders when they take responsibility for the affairs of the believers. Right? This is a sickness. And we don't want sick people making decisions on our behalf. If someone has cataracts in their eyes, right, or some other like serious health condition, we're not going to let them be the drivers of the bus that has our children on it. But we let other people drive our communities because they want it, because they're the most bodacious. Because they're going to kick and scream and whine and make a scene and make us all miserable if we don't give it to them. And so we give it to them. Why? I'll let you fill in the blank. Well, I've already said it several times. So Omar is saying, I really wanted it that day. Right? Why? I wanted to be the one who loved Allah and His Messenger, and Allah and His Messenger loved me. And Allah will manifest success for the Ummah at my hands. That was a very inviting thing. And if I had been the one who was selected in Haqq, I would have been that person. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was a mutakallim. Right? He was a theologian. He was a metaphysician. He knew what the Haqq was. Why? Because ilm al-kalam, what the Sunnis, Sunni ilm al-kalam, right? What I said earlier, that was Mu'tazilite ilm al-kalam that Imam al-Shafi'i didn't like. But later, years after Imam al-Shafi'i, there would come another thing that was called ilm al-kalam, which was Sunni ilm al-kalam. At the time of the Sahaba, ilm al-kalam was a knowledge that had no name. Now it's a knowledge that hardly anybody understands. And then we just cry about how atheism seems to be attracting our children and how we don't have any responses to the types of things that are said at the university and in books and movies and television shows and Discovery Channel documentaries and all those places where it's embedded, but we cannot recognize it because we don't have any ilm al-kalam. We thought it would be a clever thing to get rid of it at the turn of the 20th century. But that's another discussion that you probably heard me talk about too much. So Omar wanted to be that person. He said so. تَسَاوَرْتُ لَهَا رَجَاءَ أَنْ أُدْعَى لَهَا. So I jumped at the chance. hoping that I would be the one he would call out, right? And in the other narration, he says, so all of the people laid awake that night, especially me, right? Hoping that tomorrow it would be my name that was called. فَدَعَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَلِيَّ بْنَ أَبِي طَالِبٍ. So the next morning, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called Ali ibn Abi Talib out. And أَعْطَاهُ فَأَعْطَاهُ إِيَّاهَا. So he gave the banner to Ali and he gave him the instructions. إِمْشِي وَلَا تَلْتَفِتْ. And here is the badiru. Here is the rush to do good with resolve and without hesitation in all due seriousness. And look at the seriousness of Ali ibn Abi Talib. He gave him the instructions as he gives him the raya. But what's the raya, right? This is not a parade. It's not the banner. I want to be the one to carry the pink flag or the green flag or what have you, right? Because that's cool. Like, I want to be the one to carry the pinwheel in the wind and stuff like that. That's not what the raya is. Nobody had, right, communication systems on the battlefield back then. They had banners. So there's a main banner, right? And then every single group, battle group, has its own banner. And the battle commander is in the back. He has aides-de-camp. What are aides-de-camp? Right? Not just someone who hangs out and makes you coffee. The aides-de-camp are very young officers who are on horseback, and the commander has to see all of his banners. He's sending communications back and forth with his group of young officers in his entourage, his retinue. They're going back and coming, so he knows that under each banner and sub-banner, right, there's a sub-commander who's in charge, right? And what happens is that banner stays up and cannot fall, because then the person who's orchestrating the chess game, he can't see where his main groups are at. And each banner has a particular insignia that tells him what the abilities or skill sets or purposes of that group is. Okay, so he's running the chessboard from the back. But more importantly, the person with the main raya, the main banner, and each of the sub-banners has to keep it up and push forward. And everyone who's fighting, they're in this little debacle here, and this little debacle here, and they're wrapped up with this guy who's like a really good fighter and all of this, but out of the corner of their eye, they're watching their banner. So if everyone's trying to sort of, you know, make their headway with a different opponent on the battlefield, what happens if that banner drops? That fighting force, that small fighting force, scatters. Because everyone out of the corner of their eye, they can't see where they're supposed to stick close to, right? And then the person with the banner, right, is supposed to push forward, right, as much as he can, and then he's telling him what he's sending messages with what he's seeing, he's getting instructions, go this way, come back, go forward, all of this. If the banner falls, it's over. And of course, the big banner, right, is the center of the main push. And someone might be outflanking, someone might be doing this, all of these things are going. Guys, just read War and Peace. It's all in there, right? And it's a good read, too. But I met this brother, a French-American brother, who is like from a family that still speaks French, and he told me that he read War and Peace, and I said, wow, because, you know, War and Peace is like a brick, right? I said, that's impressive. He said, well, when you're in prison, don't have a lot else to do, right? I said, wow. So I went back to Syria, and I read War and Peace, and it was so good, I couldn't put it down. It was so good, I did Anna Karenina after that, right? SubhanAllah. But anyway, so, yeah, Rabbi. Na'am. So, this is the raya, and it's incredibly important. Raya zikr khair. This is the raya, and it's incredibly important, right? And the big raya went to Ali ibn Abi Talib. So the instructions are this. Rasulullah gives him the raya. That's confidence and that's prestige, because he's the main one. The main raya is the one that's pushing the force forward at Khaybar. And he gives him the instructions here in this narration, imshi wa la taltafit hatta yaftah Allahu alayk. In another narration, imdi wa la taltafit, go forward and don't look right or left. Don't look back. So Ali ibn Abi Talib walks forward, just like he was told, and the battle commences, the attack commences. He gets so many meters forward and he has a question. So he stops and he has a question for Rasulullah who's back there, but he was told not to yaltafit. So he hollers out, right? And in the other narration that we'll close with, right? He hollers out, shall I fight them until they become like us? Shall I fight them until they become like us? And he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we'll close with the adhan. He said, go forward and let them know their responsibilities to their creator. The objective is not necessarily to make them like us. And this narration means the same thing. Notice Ali walks forward, does not yet tell it. That's the belief of the objectives and the mission of Muhammad. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah.